spoke the word of God, God created the whole universe, the world that we live in. The trees that we see outside, they came forth by the word of God. And John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the word. The word was with God, and the word was God. Verse 14 says, and that word was made flesh, and it dwelt among us. And I'm glad to tell you tonight that I know what his name is. His name is Jesus.
Jesus.
Who is this king of love?
chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14 says, and that Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And I'm glad to tell you tonight that I know what His name is. His name is Jesus.
Jesus.
You are the rose of Sharon.
Can we go ahead and come around the front? And we're going to take some prayer requests. And Sister Nancy is really feeling horrible tonight. And we want to remember Christopher. What is Christopher's last name? Morris. Let's remember not just Christopher, let's remember his family. When someone's as sick as he is, it takes a toll on the whole family. So let's remember that family tonight in prayer. Do we have any other special prayer requests tonight? Do we have anyone that needs prayer tonight? Sister Beverly has a special unspoken. Go ahead. Wow. Okay, we have needs. We have needs. You know, church, when we come into the house of the Lord, we need to walk in here ministering to those things that people, you know, we have friends, we have family, we have people, and they're looking to us. They really are. They're hoping that you can tell them it's going to be okay, or God is with you, or a pat on the back. We're his hands. We're his feet. Everywhere we go, we represent him. We are, what is that word, ambassadors in a foreign country. In a foreign world, we're ambassadors of Christ. So tonight, let's pray over these circumstances. Brother Chandler is not here tonight. I'm it. And he pulled a sneaky. He went to see his mom, and he needed that. He really needed to go see his mom. It's been several months, and his mom is 83, and she's gathering some years, and he needs those times with her. So let's pray for him. He goes tomorrow for his pre-op, and Monday he has to have eye surgery again. It's not as drastic as the other, but it's still, you know, we laughed. We said it this way. Neither was the laser surgery. It was not supposed to be anything. Everybody said, oh, it's no big deal. You'll go in. You'll have it. You'll go home. Yeah, well, that was how many months ago, and we're having another surgery. So he's had a pretty rough time. So y'all remember him in prayer. Let's go ahead and pray for these things. Lord, we just so honor your presence, God. We're so thankful that we can come into the house of the Lord, God, and we can bring names that belong to lives and families before your throne. God, we trust you, God, to touch Christopher. God, we are just saddened in our heart that, God, his life has been so attacked, oh God, by sickness. Father, minister to his little wife and their children and their family, his parents, his aunts and uncles. God, because they're heartbroken, God. They don't know how this is going to turn out, God. But Father, when we trust you, God, when we put our confidence in you, God, it's going to be okay no matter what, Lord. Because, Lord, we know you know the beginning and you know the end. And, God, we trust you, God, to fix and to touch and to minister. God, we ask you to touch Sister Nancy tonight. God, I'm asking you to minister to Sister Nancy's body, God. Heal her, fix her body, God. I'm asking you, Lord, to do a miracle in her life tonight. God, I ask you, Sister Michelle's friend, God, touch that situation. God, we ask it in the name of the Lord that you would minister, God. You go forth, oh God, and minister to that life. God, by your spirit, Sister Missy, did you have a special prayer? Oh, yes, allergies. Anybody know what that is? Can we get some men? Brother Chad, will you come do oil? I don't like to do oil. I know that's, I'm not a, yeah. Let's pray over Sister Misty. God, by your Spirit, Father, I ask you, Lord, to minister to her body tonight. God, these allergies, God, I'm asking you, Father, to just touch her. I'm asking you, Father, to minister strength to her body, healing to her body. God, I'm asking in the name of the Lord that you would just cover her. God, do a work. Oh, God, do a work. God, by your Spirit, Father, in your name, Jesus, we just praise your name tonight, God. I worship you, Lord. God, we worship you. Father, we just exalt. Let's go ahead and just praise him. God, we worship you in this house tonight. God, we love you, Lord. God, minister in the house tonight, God. Do a work among us, Jesus. Do a work in our lives. Oh, Jesus, we need you. We need you, Lord. We need you, Jesus. You go a day without him and see if you don't need him. Go a day without him and see if we don't need him. I can't imagine a day without him. Let's go ahead and go around and shake someone's hand and tell them we're so glad you're here today. We're so glad you came. When you're tired in your body, it's easy to stay home, but you're here.
The blood.
Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Do you trust any? Do you trust that the blood washes? Do you trust that the blood washes? Oh, yes, we do.
What can wash away my sin?
Oh, nothing.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Sing it like you mean it.
And make me whole again.
Oh, nothing. Nothing but the blood. Oh, yeah.
Oh, precious is the flow.
Yeah.
When makes me white as snow. No other mountain top.
Oh, nothing.
Nothing but the blood.
What
can make me whole again?
Oh,
the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is that blood.
Oh, yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood. Lord, we thank you for the blood tonight. We honor you, Lord. The blood of the Lamb. It is by His blood that we are made worthy, that we can walk in here tonight and lift our hands because we're free. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing in our lives. God, we worship you in this house tonight. We exalt that name that's above every name, Lord. You said at that name, every knee would bow and every tongue will confess that you are Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
To worship you, I live.
Yes.
To worship you, I live to worship you.
Yes, we do. Oh, Yalabahasataye.
To worship you, I live.
Yes.
To worship you, I live to worship you.
Thank you, Jesus. Do you mean it?
To worship.
Oh, thank you, Lord.
To worship you. I live to worship you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. we just raise our hands? Lord, I love you. I may not understand everything, but I know, God, when I'm in your presence, Lord, that all the chains start falling, that the enemy has no power when I praise your name, Lord. And God, tonight I worship you. I worship you. I exalt that name tonight. Oh, thank you, Jesus. The word says this. The word says this. It says, put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. And sometimes, I don't know about you, but life gets tough. The word says it rains on the just and the unjust. So you know what that means? No matter where you are, no matter who we are, things are going to happen. This is the real world. But the word says put on the garment of praise. It's when we start praising that things start falling around us, that it has no power anymore, that I start lifting higher. See, when the rapture of the church takes place, we're going up, not down. Okay? So we're going to raise our hands and we're going to say, Lord, I love you tonight. And I'm going to put on that garment of praise. And I'm going to worship you because you're worthy. You're worthy of everything I can do. God, I have nothing, God, in this flesh but my worship. But my worship, God. And I praise you tonight. I'm so thankful, Lord, that I can come before your throne and worship. And all those things start falling. All those heavy weights start falling to the ground because it doesn't have any power anymore. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah! Can you say that? Can you say it? God, I find joy. It's in your presence I find peace of mind. It's in your presence that my mind comes under control. Some of you walked in here tonight and your mind's going like this. You remember, oh, years ago we had tops. When I was a little kid, we had a top and we'd shoot that thing out there and it'd spin. Some of your minds are doing that tonight. They're just going like that. You know what? It's time that we set aside some things. Because when we walk into the house of God, we need to be able to be free to lift our hands, to worship Him, and set down some things. Because the enemy plays tricks on your mind. Woo! He is a tricker. I'm going to read you a scripture. John 10:10 says, and the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. And Jesus is talking and he says, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. That is one of my favorite scriptures because it totally identifies my battle. It totally puts my battle into perspective because I know when I'm battling where it came from. He is a thief. He is a liar. He is a destroyer of your faith. He tries to discredit all the things that God is doing. And we think it's just normal. No, it's not normal. He's a liar. He is a thief. I've got this lesson. I haven't prepared it, but it's going to be so good. I'm excited about it. When I get it together, I'm going to like it. Because I want to identify all of his thievery in some of your lives. He has stolen. He's took years. He's took family members. He's took your money. He's took your friends. He took from you. He took from me. And then the word says, but I am come. Jesus is saying, I have come that you might have life. Come on, where did all the depression, where does all the fear, where does all the confusion come from? Does it come from the one that said, I'm going to give you life? Think about it. He wants to take. He doesn't give. And Jesus came to give. If you have any peace in your world, any, it didn't come from the thief. If you have any joy in your life, it didn't come from the thief. It came from the one that said, I come to give you life. Yes. Go ahead, clap. He deserves it. He deserves it. Identify. Identify. Where does your thievery come from? Where does the things come from that has ripped you off? Mark them. Write you a list. Think of all the things he took and all the things God gave. You probably have pages of the things that have been taken from your life. You know, I was teaching a Bible study the other night. Never thought about it. In the first book of the Bible, right off the bat, when Adam and Eve are in the garden, and Adam realized that he had done something wrong. The word says he had fear. He had fear. Where'd the fear come from? It came from the serpent that entered the garden. That was the first place in the word where fear is mentioned. And this is a fearful generation. It is a fearful generation. Where did fear come from? I think you know where it came from. Let's stand. We're going to give to the Lord tonight. You know what I want you to do? If you didn't even plan on giving an offering tonight, pull a dollar. If nothing else, pull a dollar out of your purse or your wallet tonight. $1. $1. We are oneness. Let's pull $1. I could have said five. I just said one. Pull $1 out. I want everyone in here, if you have $1 in your wallet, or your billfold. Now, if you planned on giving more, praise God, hallelujah, I'm not going to tell you no. But if you didn't plan on giving, you just became a giver. Father, I am asking you to bless the people of God tonight. Lord, every person that gives in this place, I'm asking you to show them the increase of their giving. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless your people as they come and give. Now, everyone, should come forward tonight with their dollar. Everyone. Don't just send your kids. You come up here, mamas and dads. Tonight. I know you've heard of MIT, the class that we have for ministry and training. These are men, women that have felt a call from the Lord to minister in one aspect or another. And we are going to allow the women, some of the women, we have several. We don't have time for everybody tonight. But we're going to allow some of the women of MIT tonight are going to be our speakers. So you are going to be blessed. But before we begin that, Sister Shan, I want you to come and I want you to explain. We are revamping some things in the church, finances. We're trying to get some things together that we haven't done as good as we could have. So she is going to be helping me with that. And then Brother Shad, when she gets through, would you come up and minister?
Praise the Lord. Well, for those of you who were in the business meeting, we have finally made effective our accounts. So to all of you who are givers, which we have changed things in our accounting. So normally you would write 1,000 checks for all 1,000 ministries you would like to give your donations to. You no longer have to do that anymore. Praise the Lord. You don't have to waste all 25 checks in your checkbook anymore. So listen closely so I can explain to you our new system. We now have it where you still write your admin, your tithing check, your to just your tithing. And then anything you want to donate to general offering, missions, or building fund are all clamped together. Let me say that again. Missions, building, and general are all three together. And then anything else that you want to donate to, meaning children's ministry, youth, music, outreach, singles, yada, college and career. Well, college and career currently has an account until after their trip in October because they have their card still in use. After October 18th, they are going away too, and they're becoming part of this whole system of everything else. So now it's three checks only. If you are confused, it's okay. Just write one and individualize where you want it to go, and we'll just do transfers. It just makes it easier to not have to transfer everything. So admin, meaning tithes. Then in your general offering, your missions, and your building fund are all one. Then everything else is another. Does that make sense? Pretty simple. So hallelujah, we are on the road to making our finances look amazing. And Sister Chandler, shall we tell the good news? We got our check from the lawsuit today. Hallelujah.
Right. It's very exciting to see the way our church is growing. Shan's doing an amazing job. I can tell you that the secretarial, the business of the church, is a lot more than you really think it is. It's very, very detail oriented. She protects us. There's all kinds of legal stuff. It's pretty awesome. Another thing I'm pretty excited about is we have a cardboard box in the hallway. Your pastor. We found a water fountain, very cheap. Brother Chandler saved us a lot of money on this water fountain. So, Robert, yes. It doesn't sound that exciting until you realize that the fact that we get a water fountain and we don't have puddles on the floor anymore protects us from multi-million-dollar lawsuits. So that's a huge thing, right? Okay, so on October the 11th, we're going to have it's actually going to be a really large outreach event at Tractor Supply. The date's locked in. It's going to be from 10 to 1. We're going to start setting up at 9 a.m. I have a sign-up sheet. We have multiple positions available. So I'm just going to run down these positions real quick and give you a general description, okay? It's going to be ultra-organized, okay? And it's not, there's supervisory positions, there's floaters, laborers. And it's not that someone's over you. It's not that someone's in charge of you. It's just it's going to flow. It's going to flow. That's what that's all about, is to make it flow. So there's no confusion. Everybody has an understanding of what they're going to do. After church or in a little bit, I'm going to put this in the back of the church, and please sign up. If you sign up to work, you have to be there. You have to be there because we're going to depend on you. So Pastor Chandler is going to be floating. He's going to be a greeter. He's going to be speaking because we're going to have music. We're going to have food. We're going to have multiple tables of free clothing for the general public to come shop and choose from. And so Pastor Chandler, all he has to do is pastor, talk to people, you know, glad hand, shake hands, minister to people. And then it's an evangelical street meeting. It's not a pulpit meeting. So he's going to come up and he's going to go back to his evangelical days, and he's going to sling a little bit of truth through the microphone. I'll be the MC, the general supervisor over anybody. So the supervisors will come to me. We have a floating greeter, speaker. So this is going to be anybody that wants to speak, anybody that wants to get behind the mic. Amen. Well, anybody really. You can have. Well, okay, MIT. Any of the MIT guys, if you want to move toward an evangelical message, it's not a pulpit message. It's more of a compel them, not a hard message, right? Because these are unchurched, you know. So testimonies. There's spots for that. Music station supervisor Leanne, she's gonna float when they're not singing. She's gonna float. She's gonna be like a utility. Of course, Gabe's on the drums, Josh guitar, David on the bass. The musicians need to know that you still need to sign up for a spot, okay? Because I've got your spots covered when you're playing. So, when you're not playing, you'll go back to work. When you're playing, we have utility workers that'll cover you. Huh? Right, working and working. It's not going to be a full music. I told Leanne do multiple sets of 2 to 3 songs. So we're going to play for a little bit. Someone's going to get up there and preach, speak. Then she's going to come back up there and play for a little bit. She's going to be back and forth, back and forth. Sound tech supervisor, okay, Sherilyn, need a sound tech sign up. Registration table supervisor is Shan. Michelle Diaz is going to be on the registration table also. Food station supervisor is Sister Chandler. We're going to need a ticket taper. A ticket taker, 2 food helpers, 2 drink helpers, and that way, if there's any issues, it'll just go to Sister Chandler will be just kind of there, right, covering and just watching, make sure it flows smoothly. Clothing station supervisor Elizabeth, a ticket taker there, 2 clothing floaters. Actually, Katrina's in there, right? You said okay, so we'll need a clothing floater. And this is not an easy job because this person. Listen, you're going to have multiple people coming in here sorting and just messing the clothes up. So that's why I wanted Katrina, because she's so neat and tidy. But we're going to need someone else that's constantly going back and forth, right? As a clothing floater, you're going to be constantly going back and forth, resorting and refolding. You're probably going to touch the same item 4 to 5 times. I'm serious. Because, you know, just like a garage sale, people come in, they mess it up. And we want it to be neat. Everything's going to be sorted by gender, age, sizes. It's going to be really organized. Utility workers are going to be people that are basically, here's the deal. Utility worker, you're kind of a floater in general area. And then if a supervisor, one of the supervisors pulls you, you know, Sister Chandler or any of the other supervisors, they can pull you into work their area. But really, your job is to keep the area clean, the whole area clean, minister to people, talk to people, pray with people, don't be afraid to connect with people. So what I really want to ask is that we all know each other, okay? So when we're doing this, the point is to get to know the people that are coming in. So we're not there to talk to you. Listen, I want to have fun, but we have a mission, we have a goal, right? And that's to grow the church, to minister to the city. So we're talking to the people that are visiting, and that's your job as a utility worker, is to go up and talk to people, connect with people. Don't ask someone to pray. Don't be afraid to ask someone to pray with them. They know it's a church event. They know what they're getting into. It's not a big secret. This is the big one, and it's going to be someone that has a burden. This is going to be two very special people. And I have a concern about the safety issue with the kids over there in the parking lot, right? This isn't our regular outreach. You need to understand the volume of people that are going to be coming. We're probably going to be feeding 300 to 500 people, a lot of people. The clothing is going to go very, very quickly, so it's going to turn in from a clothing thing into a feed and then music and stuff like that. So we need 2 people, adults, for a kid corral supervisor. And what that is, that's going to be 2 adults, preferably ladies, or a man and a woman, husband and wife, to be here at the church with all of the children, the POB children, assuming the parents feel comfortable doing that, okay, for that 3-hour period. And talking about, we'll provide the pizza, you know, we'll rent them whatever, we'll put a whatever movie, you know what I mean, we'll do whatever's appropriate, a movie, whatever we got to do to entertain them for 3 hours. And I don't know, so do what? Yeah, it's a 3-hour thing, so it's you're going to. Okay, so we need 1 other person, right?
Woo, thank you.
Okay. So, okay.
Very special.
So we need 1 other person, because I couldn't do it. I'm sorry, I couldn't. sweet. That's, those are the hardest spots to fill. I love you guys. So you need to, Christine, get with Heather. Y'all make a list of what y'all want to do, what you need, pizza, you know, that kind of thing.
Games,
and let's figure it out, and we'll get you taken care of. I don't know, you know, I'd like to give the parents a little leeway, because there's those of us that don't have any kids, we can go in and set up, you know what I mean? And that way it reduces the burden onto you guys, you know? So you tell me, y'all figure out what you're going to do, let me know, y'all plan your thing, or not little thing, but, and we're going to get that straightened out. It's very important on this, that's not the first time you're going to hear this. If you sign up for a role, if you sign up for a spot, you have to stay in that spot, okay? And unless it's supervised, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, yeah, that's it. This is going to be awesome. It's going to be a huge event for our church. We're already getting great response. So.
And we're all going to participate, right?
Yay!
Yay! We're going to touch this city, okay?
Amen.
We're going to minister to our city. That's what God called us to do.
If anybody has clothes, please go through your closets, because we're still needing more clothes. If you can wash them before you bring them, that's even better, because we've already done where's Elizabeth?
Or Jillian Lowe.
Elizabeth has got clothes coming out her ears, and Michelle and a couple other ones. Oh yeah, Michelle and
clothes.
Baby clothes are great.
Any clothes.
Any kind of clothing. Just not. We're not doing shoes, but. Any kind of clothing, please. Good used clothing.
Good used
clothing. If you can wash it and bring it already washed, that would be great.
Yeah.
Yes, please. So, this is for the 11th, so anytime between now and probably that Wednesday before, so that we'll know what we have.
Y'all don't tell Brother Chandler, but I'm cleaning out his closet.
All right.
Don't tell him.
All those clothes that are too
big. He always says, don't get rid of that, honey. I might be able to get into it soon. I'm like, okay. They've changed styles 5 years ago. Okay, let's stand. We are going to introduce our first MIT speaker. And she is anointed of the Lord. And I love her. And she has a word from God for us. So let's pray before we start. And let's ask God to bless her. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless Sister Heather, God, and bless Sister Leanne, and bless Sister Suzanne tonight as they minister to us. God, give us a word from the throne. And God, we trust you, Lord, to minister to her as she ministers to us. In the name of Jesus, amen. You may be seated.
I think that spot's taken. little nervous tonight, but that's okay. When I was asked to speak, the first thing that came to mind was forgiveness. This was hard for me as I was growing in God, and I had to overcome every obstacle from my past in order to continue growing. So I want to start with my testimony. I grew up in a preacher's home. My dad was and is a good man that didn't realize the pain I found due to his words. At about 10, my world came crashing down when my dad started getting really, really sick. And in those early days, it was, we don't know how long, but a couple years, you know, and now, of course, we're 29 or 28 years later, but he went from being this very vibrant man that was my rock and had ministered to me in numerous ways, and I watched him minister before he got sick, and then he didn't let anything come in his way. But then he went to a man that was very ill and couldn't provide for his family. Chronic pain, if you guys have ever dealt with that, has a way of changing everything about you and your personality, and the pain medicines alter that personality. His chronic pain, coupled with a strong-willed child, who was me, did not bode well for peace in the home. During the years after his diagnosis, he and I butt heads frequently. I was told that I wouldn't amount to anything and called names that cut deeper than any physical wound I could have ever received. I recall screaming matches that led to very hurtful things. We're both very strong-willed, and our family went through an awful time of adjustment and depression wore on us. Thankfully, our relationship did eventually to heal, and we called a truce when I was about 18. By this time, I was more able to handle the way I reacted to him in pain, and he learned more how to deal with that chronic pain. Now, the pain from those words paled in comparison to what I experienced at the hands of my grandfather. When I was about 9 or 10, I was abused by my grandfather. We moved away from my grandparents, and I found out when I was 17 that my grandfather had not only hurt me, but he had hurt every one of my mom's sisters, including her. Even with that revelation, I still couldn't tell anyone. I just couldn't do it. It would take me 9 long years to tell someone that that abuse occurred. My safety net was in my husband. My husband was the first person I told, and he helped me to tell my parents, and healing started. My parents had been so protective over my childhood that they could name the exact time and place that it happened 7 years later. So it caused a lot of pain for them too, because they had felt that they failed me in some way. About this time, Jason and I were engaged and I received the Holy Ghost. My grandmother was the only reason I went to see my grandparents, and after her death, I just couldn't make myself see that man. I just couldn't do it. I had such a hard time because my mother would tell me, and this was her calling me from Colorado or Indiana, saying, you need to go see your grandfather. I said, no, I can't. But her rationale was, well, he's still your grandfather. I said, well, you don't have to see him because you live 1,000 miles away. So she couldn't understand why I acted the way I did towards him. It was just too hard to face, so I buried my head for quite a while. So I received the Holy Ghost, but I never really healed. But eventually, Pastor Chandler preached a message to me, or at least I felt like it was just to me, on how we can forgive the sinner but not trust that person again. God began to unwind the pain that memory had brought to me every time I thought about it. At the time, Pastor didn't know about the abuse, but as God took away the pain, I was able to handle that memory without the hurt or the pain that went through it. It's like a movie playing in your mind. You know what happened, but the pain wasn't behind it. I wish I could say that it was just removed in an instant, but it wasn't. God would bring something to mind and we would work through it, and the process would start over. Over and over, this happened. So I felt like my heart was ripped apart over and over until I truly felt forgiveness for him and my father. When my grandfather passed away a year ago, I went to his funeral, and I can honestly say that I had forgiven him. Unfortunately, he thought he did nothing wrong up until the day he died. So he didn't, or rather, wouldn't find the grace of God that I prayed for him after I forgave him. So leading into that, my testimony is, what does the Bible say about forgiveness? Number one, we should forgive because we are forgiven. In Matthew 6:14-15 says, for if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And in Colossians 3:13, forbearing one another and forgiving one another, if any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave him, also do ye. We also need to be ready to forgive over and over. As you remember when Peter in Matthew, in the book of Matthew, when Peter came and asked Jesus, then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times? Jesus said, no. I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children on all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him and said, be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But what did this man do next? But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me and I will pay it back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. So even though he had been pardoned, he had another man sent to prison. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in, you wicked servant, I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he could pay them back what he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. Now, one of the things that Pastor taught me a long time ago was forgiveness doesn't mean that you trust the person again or you put yourself back in a circumstance to get hurt. So in my situation, I was very protective of myself and of anyone that was around my grandfather. I was very protective. I can't say that my cousins did so well. So the abuse continued for generations. But I was able to forgive him. I just didn't let him do it again. The other thing is love will lead to forgiving others. So if we love someone, we have to forgive them. Whenever we pray for our enemies, we begin to grow that love for them. In 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 6, it says, love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. And finally, Jesus is our model. Whenever I think about holding a grudge against someone, I think about Jesus on the cross. And it was with his last breath. He said, when they came to a place called the skull, there where they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. So he was our ultimate example. When he was dying, he asked God to forgive. So how am I not to give that forgiveness to someone else? Because what if my unforgiveness is what's keeping them from getting the Holy Ghost, or it's keeping them from coming to church, or it's becoming that stumbling block for them? How do we get there? I'd say it's a lot of prayer and fasting. Whenever I talked about how God had peeled away things, sort of like an onion. Our hearts like that. So we have some of us have just really deep hurts. God's not going to expose all of that to you at one time. He's going to take one thing. He's a gentleman, and he's going to heal us. And then he's going to do it again. He's going to do it again until we can truly forgive someone. The word says to love everyone, including those that have done wrong. No one says you have to forget the pain of the past, but the Bible does say we have to forgive. So I leave you with this. God is the healer. He was my healer, and he will be your healer too. Let him heal and trust him when he asks you to forgive those that have trespassed against you.
Wow. Thank you, Sister Heather. Oh, that was great. The thing that I'm talking about, this is how different everybody is. Thing that I'm talking about, completely different than yours. So tonight I want to talk about the kingdom of the upside down and the inside out. God, I ask you, Father, that you open our understanding. God, help us to see who we are in you. God, help us to accept who we are, what we are called to do, what our purpose is, and to do those things and walk in the things of God. In Jesus' name, amen. So the things of God are completely opposite of the things of the world. God's kingdom is not wicked, it's not perverse, it's not dark, it's not selfish or crude or cold, it's not lying, scheming, or anything of the sort. And the church and the people of God are to be the antithesis, which is the opposite of the ideas or philosophies of the world. That's the meaning of antithesis. It's the direct opposite of something or someone. A thesis is a proposition or an idea of philosophy. That's you write your thesis whenever you're getting your doctorate or whatever it is, and you're presenting an idea. So we're supposed to be the opposite of the idea that we see presented for us in the world. If you find yourself very uncomfortable these days, I was telling Sister Chandler, I feel so opposite of this world right now. Like everything that I see is a lie. Like everything that's out there, this generation that we're in right now feels so opposite of everything good and honest and right and true. If you feel really uncomfortable, it's a weird feeling. I don't think I've ever been here before in this place where I feel so out of sorts. And, you know, when you don't really know what to do with that, it's a little bit scary. You're like, I don't know where I fit. I don't fit there. I fit with something else. So if you feel yourself uncomfortable these days of being able to live in this Babylon culture, that's where we are. We're like Daniel in the midst of a captivity where everything around you is against what you believe. It's like you're trying to exist in something where everybody's doing the opposite of you. So right now, if you feel that discomfort and you're waking up and you realize that we've been hauled off into the captivity that Israel faced in Babylon, an entire generation has been desensitized to evil and wickedness, and compromise has replaced conviction. This culture that we're in is so false and anti-Christ, but they're okay if you're spiritual, just not Christian. You can be anything but this and still be okay, because it's like, oh, you can do that. Oh, that's cool. That's the newest thing. That's the newest religious, you know, move over there. But being this is so truthful that it doesn't fit with them. So whatever your choice of spirituality is, it's fine as long as it doesn't offend anyone else or cause them to be uncomfortable. So we're called to be the complete opposite of everything around us. Everything we see in Hollywood, on TV, in politics, everything that we see that's not true Christianity. What is Christianity? It's just following Christ. It's being what he is, which is hard for us as humans. But that's what we're supposed to be doing. Christianity is not some thing, you know, some fad. It's really just being as much like him as we can get. So there should be no resemblance with me and the world around me. It should be so different. There's nothing that this world has for me that's better than what God has in store for me. The Bible says, eye has not seen and ear has not heard what God has in store for those who wait on him. In this kingdom, the way up is down. The only ladder climbing in his kingdom is a downward ladder. I must decrease that he could increase. John 3:30. If you want to be revered and exalted, it starts with being a servant. If you want to be respected and you want to be, you know, the platform is really not a place for that. You're really a target when you stand here. When you take on ministry, you become a target for everything that wants to come against the church and the church people. But the first thing to being a leader is to be a servant. That's it. You just pick up something and start working. And if you're good at it, other people might follow you. Other people might join you and help. That's really the main part of being a leader, is just find something to do and serve. And that's the greatest thing, that's the way God made it. He said, oh, you know, they all sat around and they were arguing about, oh, well, God, who's going to be on your right hand and who's going to be on your left hand? They were, you know, sitting around talking to Jesus saying, well, who's going to be the greatest? And he said, yeah, that's not how it works here, boys. That's not how it works with me. You're going to have to serve. And as a matter of fact, most of you, every one of them except one, was martyred. They lost their life for what they believed. So John 12:25 says, he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life. The thing that we probably struggle with the most is getting outside of ourselves, is just being something better than what this flesh tells me I am. There are so many things that I strive to do, that I want to do, and in the end, all that striving will cease. That's really not striving with each other. It's striving to be better, striving to be more like him. That's the striving that's going to cease, and that's the good part. But, you know, the thing about it is, I was telling Sister Chandler the other day, we have a lot of conversations about stuff. If ISIS came rolling through Bastrop, Texas, and you were, could you honestly say that you would allow someone to torture you, your family members, your children, and that you would not deny Jesus? I mean, we all think about that. We have those little movies that play out in here. And we all think about, not me. I would, you know, do this and I would do that. But we have a struggle with committing to ministry. We have a struggle with writing a tithe check. We have a struggle with, you know, different things like presenting ourselves modestly or any of those things. Those are the struggles we have, but we're saying that if it came down to it now, I would give up my life for God, but we don't live that way most of the time. So I did a little research. Did you know that Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world with almost 2 billion followers? And can you put my picture up there, please? For the most conservative Islamist, the women wear burqas fully covered from head to toe. Only their eyes are showing through their head covering. And they're following the wrong religion with a false god, a false prophet, and false doctrine. One that promotes killing of innocent people who don't subscribe to their caliphate. And we have a problem with the things that we do. I mean, really. Honestly, that's dedication right there. For real. And if they can get 2 billion people to follow that, we got to get with it. Because they have everything that's the opposite, you know, of what we have. The real God, the true God, the living God. When we talk about, the Bible says that man looks upon the outward, but God looks upon the heart. What does modesty show? It shows self-respect. That's what that shows. That's really it. It's not about nothing else. You can take that down. Thank you. But what is that? I'm respecting myself when I'm modest. I'm respecting, you know, what I represent. But the Bible says that man looks upon the outward, God looks upon the heart. A lot of people use that scripture as justification for unrighteous behavior, a cop-out to walk outside of the will of God and say, well, God knows my heart. That's what we usually... We're like, well, God knows my heart. Yeah, but he sees your actions.
And that's really, I was reading this and I was like, you know what? That scripture really isn't helping you any, because God really does see your heart and he knows exactly why you do what you do. And I'm kind of like, I'd rather him not look at my heart, really. I'd rather him not see that. That'd probably be better if he didn't. But when you look at the way Jesus explained it in Matthew 23, he said, first cleanse the inside. And what he was talking about, he wasn't saying ignore the outside. He said, work on that. That's the important part. Who are you inside? That's what you need to work on. And that's the inside is seen more by God, because that's where the very intentions and the true motives are seen. Those things that we hide from man cannot be hidden from God. This scripture does nothing to help us. It would be better if God didn't see the depths of my heart. He knows that my heart is deceitfully wicked, and who can know it? God can. He knows it. But we're called to be so much different than everything around us. I admire Daniel. I admire Joseph, who stood in captivity and kept their integrity. We're not captive. We're free to do whatever we want. So if we can't maintain our integrity in this culture, we're really free to do what we want to. And we're, you know, afraid to offend anybody and stuff like that. They're not afraid to offend you. They're not afraid to tell you exactly what they think of what you do and how you do it. And they're not afraid to show you what they do at any time. So I'm not ashamed of anything that we do. I'm proud to be a one God, apostolic, Holy Ghost filled, Jesus name, baptized, born again believer. I'm fine with how I look and what I do. If you're okay with that, good. If you're not, that's okay too. But everything we have is so valuable. We are the last of our kind. There was somebody that told Brother Bernard, he read it in a message. It was called In Jesus' Name. It was a message that he preached at General Conference a year or two ago. And there was a denominational pastor, not of our faith, sent him a letter and said, don't let go of what you have there. You're the last ones. We're the last ones to hold out for the real truths of God. And if we don't carry it on, if our children don't get it, what comes after them? What if they don't pass it down to their kids? Then what is left? This is it. We have to teach. Can we teach our kids a scripture here and there? Like a real scripture? You'd be surprised what our kids don't know. You know? Like, they know every word to, well, back when my kids were little, Barney songs. I don't know what they know now. The Door of the Explorer, Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood, all that stuff. They know every word of those songs, but could not tell you one scripture. You know what I'm saying? Like, that generation, they've got to carry it on. We have to pass it on. We're the last. This is it. This is the last. We got to carry it on. Somebody's got to be here to preach this message to the next generation. I hope that this is the last generation, but I keep saying, God, would you just come on? Would you just, I know there's a lot of people that still need to make it, but I'm ready to go. I'm ready to get out of here. Thank you. This is the kingdom of the upside down and the inside out. I'm not called to be of this world, but I will be everything that this world is not. Amen.
Those were some awesome messages, and I apologize, my faithful old timekeeper died on me. So if I go more than likely under, that's why. I want to go ahead and pray before I begin. God, I ask that you would anoint my lips of clay. Lord, I pray that you would bless everyone here tonight. I bind any fear that would keep anyone from receiving what you have for them tonight, in Jesus' name. I wanted to testify before I begin of some things God's been doing in my life, and it may not seem like a whole lot. It isn't anything like, you know, I ran into $1 million or anything like that. But it's just a lot of times we take for granted that God would be doing things in our life because it doesn't seem that spectacular. But I'm always looking for different things, and I'll say, oh my goodness, God, you answered one of my prayers. I'll tell Frank that all the time. I'll say, babe, don't you realize God answered a prayer for us? That's awesome. But I've started a new venture. I'm going to school full-time to get my master's degree in nursing because I'm eventually wanting to be a nurse practitioner or doctor's assistant. But I'm very excited about that. And as I went off to school for an orientation, I ran into some issues. I decided I knew the way better than my GPS. So I took a wrong route, but it turned out being shorter. I was going to run out of gas, and there was a gas station right along one of the main towns that I went through, Lano. But it just seemed like the whole time while I was going, you know, starting school, God's just been paving the way. Not to say that it's been easy, but he's girding me with strength. And I told Frank, I've never felt like this before, where I just feel he's guiding me. And it gets overwhelming sometimes because a lot of times you feel like, you know, God, are you going to help me through this? And it's like I can feel him with me the whole step of the way. But that's just my little testimony, and I'll go ahead and get into what I feel I have for someone tonight. Sister Heather, thank you for your message. That was awesome. Frank was talking about, I think he had touched a little bit on forgiveness, and I told him I felt like I got a revelation. Because, you know, a lot of times people say that it's really hindering you. You're shackled because, you know, because of what happened and the unforgiveness that may be there. And for some reason, it just hit me like this, that it could be that you're held captive to that point in time. You're held captive to the past. So you can never move forward because you're carrying that with you everywhere you go. So it just hit me like, oh, well, honey, that makes sense to me. I just, you know, I've got to let it go. Albeit it is very difficult, and it does take prayer and fasting in situations where it's deep, deep hurts. And Sister Leanne, thank you for your message too. That was amazing. The title of my message tonight is The Season of Wait. And for those of you that love grammar, I did do a little twist on the words because that really isn't how you would state that, but I like to do things a little bit different. So it's the season of wait. Whether you're in a season that seems unbearable, waiting for a healing, right now it feels like we're waiting on the Lord to come. It seems a little bit unbearable at times, and we're having to deal with all the things in this world when you're in the workforce and people are totally defying what you believe and they really don't care. But we're all in different seasons of life. And the nice thing about being in an unbearable season is there's something to look forward to. It's not going to last forever. So have you ever been in a place in your walk with God and nothing seems to be working just right? Or you just feel nothing? You go to prayer and you go, I think I'm here by myself. No word from God, no chill bumps. You don't feel that Holy Ghost. There's going to be times like that, but that's just when you push through. And what I love is sometimes I feel like God may be doing that so that we still cherish and we still long for that. Because sometimes I think we take it for granted when things are going right. Isaiah 40 and 31, and I'm sorry, Brother John, I didn't give you this scripture, but this was my scripture. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. During this time of waiting, I often think of this is your preparation time. The boxer before the big event, before his big match, he's preparing every day. And they're pretty intense in their training. I got to hand it to them. But they don't just sit down and, you know, wait around. They're constantly preparing themselves. Psalms 46 and 10 states, "Be still and know that I am God." When we go through those times that, you know, we feel like we're waiting either on your promise to come, your healing, just know that he's God, and he has it all under control. There is a season for everything. Ecclesiastes states, "To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven." There's also an age-old phrase that states, "All good things come to those who wait." But we don't feel that way when we're waiting. And most importantly, what are we doing during that time of waiting? When I was preparing this lesson, I thought also about the many times that we go to eat after church or after our fast. And you feel like, oh my gosh, when are they going to bring my food? My goodness, I'm starving.
Yes.
And that's how we feel when we're waiting sometimes on God. We're like, Lord, where's my steak? Where is my steak and baked potato? But sometimes, like I said, I feel like he's doing that to increase that hunger level. How hungry are we? I want you all to consider King David. He's one of my favorite men to do a character study on in the Word because of his humility and reverence he kept before the Lord. When David was anointed king, he began his season of waiting. Let me ask, what did he do during that wait? And I think this is so awesome because David was anointed, but he never just went up to King Saul and said, "Hey, dude, I'm taking your place." Right. He didn't do that. He still had respect and awe towards the king. What are you doing between now and the development of your promise? We have to prepare ourselves for the promise spoken over our future. Many times, Pastor Chandler will tell us when a prophet's coming, and then afterwards, whenever we may have been spoken over, that there is obedience hinged to that promise. Yes, we can claim it, and yes, faith does work that way, but you also still have to be striving toward God things. You can't just say, "Oh yeah, God's going to give me that, you know, $1 million that was promised to me." But if you're not doing the things that you need to do to be pleasing in God's eyes, then you're delaying that promise.
Right, that's
good. We have to prepare ourselves for the promise spoken over our future. That's faith. And God cannot breathe life into that promise without your faith. It takes you in preparation. The word says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." 2 Timothy 2 and 15. When I read this, when I was preparing this lesson, I thought to myself, you know, we use that a lot in Bible study. We talk about, you know, that phrase because we're saying to use the scripture that you're trying to explain in context. But this also speaks to me to prepare yourself, because guess what? Study, it doesn't say right there that study is just for Bible study teachers or study is just for preachers or ministers. It's for all of us to get us to heaven. David is anointed king. And he continued to serve the Lord by singing and submitting under the headship of King Saul, fleeing time and again to ensure his own safety and avoiding dishonor to the king. We often use that phrase, "I'm just waiting on God," and rightfully stated, we do have to wait on God. We have to wait on the promise in order for him to create what he's promised to us. But that does not give us grounds to stay stagnated in the waiting. We have to actively prepare and give of ourselves daily to see that promise. But I always like to throw a little wrench in the process. What if you never see your promise come to pass in your lifetime? What if? Abraham walked by faith, yet he did not get to enjoy the promised land due to the famine that affected the area. And one thing that I realized in teaching Bible study is Abraham did get to enjoy it for a season, but because of the famine, they went to Egypt. Joseph spared his family. But they never went back after the famine was over. They got comfortable. The land was theirs. They could have went back, but they never did until they got put in bondage where they were. So prepare yourself anyhow. Even Jesus had a preparation period. He didn't start his ministry until he was 30. Moses had a journey before he became the great leader parting the Red Sea. Saul had a road of Damascus. Noah had an ark to build in preparation for the flood. Joseph had a dream, and his waiting period would bring most of us into despair if we had to go through those same things. So let me ask you, are you called? What are you doing today to prepare for that? Were things spoken over you in the past? What are you doing today to prepare for the promise as if it's already in fruition? I want to encourage someone tonight. You may feel like things aren't falling into place like they should, but God's saying, don't be discouraged. This is your waiting period. This is your preparation time. Don't waste this time being preoccupied with making the promise come to pass with your own might. Prepare yourself. Come into his presence, weep at the altar, and allow a transformation to take place. Because just like David, that's what he did. All those years that Saul persecuted him or was chasing after him because he knew he was next in line, he just worshiped the Lord and he wept. So are you willing to prepare yourself? Thank you.
Wow. Let's stand. Wasn't that wonderful tonight? Did you get a taste of our MIT and see what God is doing in some of our people? These ladies have something to offer. Have you ever waited? Have you ever dealt with forgiveness? Have you ever thought, this world is not my home? That's what I got out. Let's, can we sing that? This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up. Sing it, Leanne. Somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open doors. And I can't live at home in this world anymore. Well, oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. And if heaven's not my home, then Lord, what would I do? Well, the angels beckon me from heaven's open doors. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Do you ever feel that way? You ever feel that way? You go to the mall and you look around and say, "Woo, this ain't my home. I don't belong here." Let's hug someone's neck and tell them how much we love them and glad they're here. Thank you for coming. Thank you for our MIT ladies for blessing us tonight. And you are dismissed.